All the parks in the mountains particularly had non-native fish stocked.
Fish in these lakes provided opportunities for people to come up to an incredible alpine environment and come fishing. No one really realized the impact that the stocking would have.
Well, putting trout in these lakes is like putting a piranha in your fish tank.
It's weird that people would put fish into lakes where they don't belong.
The brook trout eventually outcompeted the cutthroat trout and became the only species of fish in the two lakes. And what happens is that fish do end up swimming downstream, and so these fish started moving all the way through the system, populating the Clearwater River system. The last lakes that were stocked in Banff were in 1988, and they would have been roadside type lakes. About 1972, I think the warning signs were being read by many of the fisheries biologists at that time, and they realized that it was time to stop.
It's like any landscape or ecosystem in the world that suffers from introduced species, it changes.
We've done restoration for years in parks. And it just seems so much more natural on a terrestrial level because we as humans relate a lot better to that. But if you walked into one of these parks and you saw gazelles and zebras running around, you'd be alarmed. And you walk in here and you look in the aquatic systems and it's pretty much what you've got. You've got top predators that aren't supposed to be there. And it dramatically changes the ecosystem. And because we're terrestrial beings, we don't really see that as a problem. We're hoping to try and restore a lot of the aquatic systems across the mountain parks, across parks in general, to their historically natural state.
We've had close to 2 kilometers of gill nets in the lakes fishing, initially just through the summer times in 2002 to about 2005, and then we put nets in and they just stayed in the water continuously. I'm pretty confident that we've eradicated all of the fish in the lakes. We still have nets in there. We haven't caught a fish since September 2006. The thing about it is you look at these lakes and you think nothing can be wrong, but it's actually within the lakes that you really start to see the change.
There's only two ways that people say, if you look at the literature, that you can actually get rid of fish successfully. One of them is through piscicides or fish toxins.
Our original plan at the Devon Lakes was to deploy a fish poison called rotenone into the headwaters of the Clearwater. By deploying this, we would eliminate the last of the fish that were found in the river. We decided not to use it, even though the rotenone is pretty much selective for fish. It does also impact the invertebrates that are found in the river, and we were concerned that they may not return back to reference levels or back to their historical conditions in a short period of time.
And the other way they say to be able to successfully get rid of fish is dewatering.
We're putting in aqua dams at the outlets of the upper Devon Lake and the middle Devon Lake. And the reason that we're doing that is that we're trying to stem the amount of water leaving these lakes with the dams going across, basically stopping the flows. We'll reduce the amount of water in the Clearwater River, which will give us an opportunity to get into those into about 4 kilometers of river and electrofish the remaining brook trout out of that out of the stream. We ended up putting in an aqua dam, and initially we got it filled up to about the 5-foot level, which was max, and then all of a sudden the aqua dam deflated. They provided us with another aqua dam. They flew it in the next morning, and we got it filled up by 9:45, and
it's food. Yeah, it blew exactly around the same height as the other one.
What do they think the problem is?
That, well, it's plastic. It's just weak. Weakness in the plastic.
By itself. No, we're not in the big rush here, so.
It's all she wrote.
It's all she wrote. So today is going to be a cleanup day, and we won't be continuing on with this with the dam.
What's going to happen with the rest of the project?
It'll still continue. So we'll do it no matter what, but this was supposed to be the thing that would help out the other end of the electrofishing. Adios. See you, Frank. Broken the river off into 100 meter reaches, putting in block nets at every 100 meters. The fence essentially stops any kind of movement or fish passage through or within the stream, and the PVC is weighted down, so there's no way that a fish can actually swim underneath. We split our electrofishers into 4 groups of 2. You electrofish a reach twice if you don't catch fish. If you catch a fish, then you go back in and electrofish until you do 2 successive passes without catching any fish. At about the 4 kilometer mark, there's a barrier waterfall, so fish can actually flow over the barrier waterfall, but they can't make it back. We'll be going right up to just below the lower, there's a barrier right at the outlet of the lower Devon Lake. In about 9 or 10 days time, we'll have removed all of the fish there.
Hey, I'm Alex.
I'm Jimmy, and together we're the Brook Trout Task Force.
And we're going electrofishing.
That's right.
The reason that we did that is because our first week started at 0. There's always a halo over Charlie.
Devon Lakes, good morning.
Hey, how are you folks today?
I think everybody's doing good. We've got a little bit of snow falling right now. We're going to be working on the river, and we're all back at the same location tonight.
Right.
We're kind of hoping for a little bit better weather. So, lousy day, and so we've had to rethink kind of how we're going to get today done. So I'm thinking that we'll use the weather day to help Art and Monica and Ray out, initially at least in the morning, to move block nets.
So. I think it's probably snowed almost every year that we've been here. In fact, I can't recall a time where we haven't had snow, but on some occasions, we've had up to 1 meter of snow.
Hey, Having a good day?
Great day. Last day of summer. It's great. But best weather ever.
Well, guess what? We're almost done. We've come up to the base of the Lower Devon Lake. So the outlet of the Lower Devon Lake is probably 40 meters up. We have a barrier waterfall here. So fish can't make it through the, can't make it upstream from the barrier waterfall. So we fished right to this point. There's still three other teams on the river, but they're probably 10 or 15 minutes away from being done. And so far, that's the number of brookies that we've got, so.
How did it feel to be done?
Excellent. Yeah, you know, satisfying. We're happy.
We're done.
We're done.
Let's go have lunch.
Not everything worked out as well as we had hoped, but we put in 130,000 seconds of electrofishing effort into the creek, and we didn't catch any fish. So with last year's capture of one fish and zero this year, I'm feeling pretty confident that we've taken care of all the fish in the upper Clearwater.
One of the biggest concerns we have as biologists or people in general is climate change, and that's going to be a huge stress on our natural systems. And any creatures that have evolved over eons to survive in a system with all the different parts, if there's something that can survive and adapt in time to still be able to be there with a stressor as strong as climate change or others, it's probably the native community of plants and animals that was there originally.
I think visitors to this area probably would expect that this area is in a very pristine type state. I'm not sure whether or not that's just a feeling that people have, that, you know, they feel, hey, this is, it feels pristine here, it doesn't look like it's been touched. And, you know, we've been able to basically bring some of that back to that state.
This isn't a quick fix. You know, it's something that you have to learn the system intricately. Charlie's been here since 2001 and knows this place inside out. And if you do want to fix something, you need to know as much as you possibly can about the system before you go tinkering. And that's one of the things I'll for sure take back is go and learn your systems and then decide what the best way to try and tackle the challenges are. And also that it can be done. I think that's a pretty important message to take back is don't give up. It is a huge challenge, especially when there's complexities like tributaries and more than one lake and when the systems are complex like this, but it still can be done. We say that national parks is the kind of last bastion of wilderness and natural protected areas in Canada. And if there's somewhere where things should be the way they were before we meddled them up, perhaps this is where that is. And this is one place where we said, actually, that's our policy. That's what we're going to do here to the best of our ability.
How does it feel to be leaving today and going away from this, you know, not probably never coming back here in the same way that you're coming here?
Feels a little sad. But I feel quite happy that we did it. So.
Okay, I want your head right in here. Yeah, right about there. And that's when you go zero.
Zero. Zero fish!
Okay, so next.
No fish.
I didn't see a fish, smell a fish, or catch a fish. Zero fish.
Being skunked. Haven't seen a fish all week. Zero.
No fish.
Zero fish.
Nar fish in the brook, Raymond. Nar fish.
Not something I usually brag about, but got skunked. No fish.
It's mighty poor fishing around here, I'll tell you.
No fish, no kill. Go vegetarian. Woohoo!
Zero fish.